May the God of peace sanctify you completely. May your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Lord God, you are faithful and you will do this for us. Sanctify each of us here. Speak to us. Move among us. Lord, would you speak to us from your word? Would you speak into our hearts? Would you use me this morning, Lord? And Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. Amen. Do you recognize anyone in this picture? Anyone guess where it is? OPC. This is Ontario Pioneer Camp up in Huntsville. And you don't recognize anyone? Joe does. There's a little pointer on this. This one here. This picture's from 1994. And that's me. It's John Bon Jovi. Oh, living on a prayer. And I just want you to wonder what they made of me. Ontario Pioneer Camp. I'm 18 years old. I've come out from England with a friend, randomly. I thought I'd do Camp America, but a friend from the Christian group at my school said, who would like to come to Pioneer Camp with me? And I thought, like Camp America, it'd be full of all these international counselors, but actually, I was the only one. Everyone else there was Canadian. They'd all gone to this camp since they were five. They all knew each other. And there's me, this strange foreigner. And I'm wondering if you can think what they made of me, because this is how I look when I got off the bus. This one's actually taken in Ireland. And the thing I didn't know was, at this time, Pioneer was quite a conservative place. Do you know? The camp had conservative Christian values, as well it should. And Christian culture in England and Ontario was slightly different. And I didn't know what I was heading to. And I got off the bus to Huntsville Pioneer Camp with hair halfway down my back. I actually had a tie-dye shirt with concentric circles. It was black and white. Torn jeans and cowboy boots. And this very odd large leather hat, which I just thought was cool. And they were already quite clean cut. I got told off for wearing Speedos once. Do you know, they had everything was right. It's a cultural difference. What? And for years afterwards, when I met a Canadian, I'd say, oh yeah, Canada, such a puritanical place, isn't it? It's very straight-laced. Everything's... And they would say, so where did you go in Canada? I'd say, boys camp, Christian boys camp, evangelical Christian boys camp, 2 months. They say, I think maybe you didn't get the whole picture of Canada at that time. So this is the age for me when I was a boy, when I was a crazy charismatic. I actually still am, just slightly less crazy. Now, crazy charismatic is not a negative term. It's not a pejorative thing, because now and again I say that and people get upset. At that time, it wasn't. I was only 18. I used to divide charismatics, people who worshipped in the power of the Spirit, who expected the Spirit to move in their lives, who expected gifts of the Spirit in their lives. I used to divide them into three groups. Woolly jumper, that would be woolly sweater to you. Common or garden, and crazy charismatic, with crazy being the good one. So woolly jumper was those people who like to wear rainbow jumpers or rainbow guitar stripes. They want to come to church in sandals and a sweater and be kind of casual and strum a guitar and sing Kumbaya, but they're not really kind of into the spiritual stuff. They just like that kind of church. Common or garden, they're just a bit more kind of ordinary. They love coming to a charismatic church, but they keep things calm. Crazy charismatic was just full on, eager for the Holy Spirit to move in you. And at this point, when I was in England, I had a group of friends who were just eager for the gifts of the Spirit. They were eager for spiritual experiences. We used to go away in summer to festivals where there'd be over 5,000 people all worshiping and praising and praying for the Spirit to move among them. They were, I remember sitting in tents and going, and people saying, oh, I wish I could be slain in the Spirit. I wonder if I could get the gift of tongues. Do you know? And they'd, I wonder if we'll see miracles. And then we'd go to these great big events and there'd be big drum kits and big noise and lots of people would be dancing. Very, very excited. And there was lots of good stuff about that. There's lots of pros and there were some cons as well. Do you know, this experience for me was wonderful. For some of my friends, I wonder if they were after the experience more than the faith. Do you know, which is a real tragedy later to see. Some of my friends fell away. They seemed to be kids who'd grown up in a Christian church and then gone, wow, experience, let's go and experience it. That'd be great. But for me, this gave me the relationship with God I have today. This being amongst people who genuinely expected God to work, God to move, God to be involved in your life. Experiencing God in me was a powerful, wonderful experience. I got a bit older and kind of pulled away a bit, had a bit of reflection, maybe a little bit of concern, but on the whole, I'd say that was all good for me. I was a full-on, crazy, charismatic. And that's why we're looking at 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. That was a good introduction, was it? Did you see the segue there? Because it was at this time in my life that this passage, this chapter, had this deep impact on me. I actually believe it was given to me by God specially. But the reason we're looking at it is because, let's get rid of him. Do you think I should grow my hair out again? Is we are rounding off our Perfect Church series. So I've been here just over 2 years, did you know? Have you noticed? March 15th was our anniversary here. So we started with Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. We did lots on Jesus. We tried to look at Jesus from lots of aspects. We didn't complete Jesus. There's so much more to say about Jesus, but we did lots on Jesus. Then I wanted us to look at how the church could be, how the church should be, looking at the early church, the first church, the church that Jesus left going, and see how we could be like them. We've come to the end of Acts. And this week, we're doing 1 Thessalonians 5. And next week, Simon's going to speak to us on Ephesians chapter 4. Then it's Easter Sunday. Then we're going to do the first epistle of John, which is all about God, God being love. And then we're going to do our personal identity in Christ from lots of different passages. It's going to be great. That sounds like he who shouldn't be named, didn't it? It's going to be great. Great, great. Not that kind of great, but it is going to be great. Now, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 isn't the ultimate passage for defining the perfect church. It's rather good, but it's not the only one there is. But it has been very, very important for me. So I was at that point in my life, struggling a bit. I was looking at things thinking, is this the Spirit moving? Is this miraculous power? Or is this kids with a lot of adrenaline? Do you know? Is this a psychosomatic? Are we being wound up and let go? Or am I seeing God working? And I'd been praying and praying for God to give me a passage. I wanted a passage of my own that God would speak to me through. And I remember I was lying in a two-man tent, and this is the passage God gave me. I remember distinctly reading it and marking it with a pencil in my Bible, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. And since then, it's been my go-to passage for whenever I've forgotten to prepare. Do you know, when you turn up at a youth group and you thought you were just going to come and say hi, but instead they say, so, here's Ben, and you've got half an hour, off you go. And you're like, what am I going to say? Or you arrive at church and they say, Ben, you know you're preaching, don't you? I could always pull out 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and talk about that till the cows come home. Unfortunately, I've now burnt that bridge. Because the week will come when Simon says, it's you, isn't it, Ben? I'll be like, no, it's you. No, Ben, I'm sure it's you. Look at this schedule. It's you, Ben. And I won't be able to do this passage anymore because we've done it now. I'll have to come up with another. So 1 Thessalonians is this great letter. It's very personal. It's not one of Paul's letters that's full of doctrine and theology. It's one of Paul's letters that shows him as a pastor, an evangelist, a missionary. It shows him as a man who is deeply caring for his church. He's writing to them about personal issues. And he's written quite soon after Paul had visited Thessalonica. You know, he's been on these journeys. You remember he went to Philippi, and everything went really well until that girl was following him and saying, "This guy's from God," and then he cast a demon out of her, and then the guys can't make money, so they put him in prison, and then there's an earthquake, and the people say to him, "You have to go. Get out of Philippi." So he leaves Philippi, and he goes on to a couple other places, comes to Thessalonica, and everything goes very well. He preaches three Saturdays, three Sabbaths. He preaches in the synagogue, and some of the Jewish people believe, and lots of the Gentile believers, they believe, and the people who don't believe get jealous, and they try to attack him, and they go to the house he's staying in, and they attack it, but he's not there, so they take the host, Jason, and they bring him before the city authorities, and the people who are in favor of Paul say, "You need to go, let's move you out of here." Then he goes on to Berea, and things go wrong there. Then he goes to Athens, and they say, we'd like to hear more about this. Then he goes on to Corinth, and when he's there, things go quite well. And he stays in Corinth for 18 months. For a year and a half, he's in Corinth. So you see on this journey, this repeated knockback. Things go well. He arrives. He tells people about Jesus. People believe. People want to hear about Jesus. Then he gets knocked back, and he has to move on. And it happens again and again. Yay! Knockback. Yay! Knockback. Yay! Knockback. Then he gets to Corinth. And he says in his letter to the Corinthians that when he began preaching there, he began his preaching in weakness and fear and with much trembling. And people speculate that's because he's kind of got used to being knocked back. Do you know that he felt that way because he was waiting for them to come and get him and put him on trial and put him in prison and beat him up and throw him out and get rid of him. So he's in Corinth, and that doesn't happen. Things go well. And then Timothy catches up with him, and Timothy encourages him. He tells him what's happened in Thessalonica, and it's going well. The people are still strong in faith, and Paul is encouraged by this. So he writes them a letter, mainly, of encouragement. And he wrote this in about 50 AD. Do you know, that's about 17 years after Jesus was crucified. 50 AD, Paul writes them, and he writes this pastoral letter. He scolds them a little bit. He praises them a little bit. He gives them guidance. He exhorts and he teaches. He shows where he's pleased with their progress. He shows where he's disappointed with their slowness. But the bit that really stood out for me, the bit that's for me back then, was verse 16. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 16. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not despise prophecies, but test everything. Hold fast to what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. That's my special bit, but we'll start back there at verse 12. We ask you, brothers, to respect those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord, and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love because of their work. That's got me in trouble in the past, because you know when I've gone to this as a go-to passage, I've done that little talk about how important this passage is to me, and then instead of starting at verse 16 where I meant to start, I start where the break is in the NIV, and then I've started reading there, and they're going, "You said this was really special," and you're saying, "Respect your ministers." It's my favorite verse in the Bible. Make sure you treat your ministers with proper respect. That's what we want. Look to them very highly in love. Well, it's a good point, but it's not the bit I'm going for. Then he tells us, be at peace among yourselves, and we urge you, brothers, admonish the idle, encourage the faint-hearted, help the weak, be patient with them all. See that no one repays anyone evil for evil, but always seek to do good to one another and to everyone. Isn't that just beautiful, straightforward, simple advice? Doesn't that sound like a beautiful church? Be at peace. Stop arguing. Love each other. Have peace in your church. We urge you, admonish the idle. That's interesting. You could kind of take on salvation and go, oh, that's great. It's lovely to be saved. I think I'll sit back and wait for the second coming now. That'll be nice. But Paul encourages us to be busy in this, to be busy in our faith, to get on with sharing the gospel, to showing Jesus' love, to telling people of Jesus' love. But he tells us to do it nicely. Admonish, encourage. If they're faint-hearted, if it's because they've got a faint heart, give them encouragement. If it's because they're weak, help them. Be patient with them all. See that no one repays anyone evil for evil. What a statement. Now, we might be thinking, oh, yes, evil. When somebody's evil, don't be evil to them. You know, doing something really horrible. But this is applicable to everyday things in our lives. Do you know? What about when she's not talking to her? And she's not talking to her because of something she said. That is repaying evil for evil. Do you know? What about when he says, you can't join my small group? Do you know? Because you did this once. We don't repay evil with evil. If somebody does something to us that we do not like, we don't do it back to them. They do not deserve it in return. Instead, we always seek to do good to one another and to everyone. Wow, that's difficult, isn't it? Do good to the people who've just really upset you. Do good where they've hurt your feelings. Do good to one another and to everyone. Do not repay evil for evil. It's beautiful. And rejoice always. Always rejoice. Always be joyful. Be joyful always. What a thing for Paul to say. Be joyful. Is that what people think about when they think about church? Do you know, when people who don't come to church, are they thinking, oh, I wish I could go to church so I could get a bit of joy. Oh, I'm feeling down today. Let's go there and pick up some joy. It's great to be amongst those joyful people who are always joyful. They don't, do they? They think we're all miserable and we just get together to share our misery. Do you know? Oh, isn't it awful? It's rubbish. Rubbish, rubbish, rubbish. No, be joyful always. This is what Paul instructs us to do. This is what Paul says to the Thessalonians. Be joyful. Be a church of joy. Let's change the name of the church. Joy Church. Church with joy. Church of joy. And isn't this what people want? Do you know, isn't this what people are looking for in the modern age? They want some joy. That's why they go on buzz things like bungee jumping or skydiving or whatever the thing is that get a buzz. I need to get feelings going in me. I need to feel good. That's why people keep on trying to get more and more money so that they can be wealthier and have more stuff so they can have some joyful time. So they can go on better holidays, so they can be joyful. We've already got it. Those things do not satisfy. Paul says, be joyful always. And this is coming from Paul. This isn't coming from a really wealthy fella sitting in a big house and say, hey guys, why don't you try being happy like me? This is coming from Paul. And Paul is getting beaten up all the time. Paul is being put in prison all the time. Paul is not living in the most comfortable of circumstances, and yet he says he has learned to be content in all circumstances. And he tells us to be joyful. Why should we be joyful? Where does our joy come from? Our joy is in Christ. In John 16, Jesus said, so also you have sorrow now, but I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice. And no one will take your joy from you. Your hearts will rejoice, and no one can take this joy from us. Because this joy comes from God. Joy is a fruit of the Spirit. If we have the Holy Spirit in our lives, joy will grow. Joy is also somewhere, it's kind of in our minds, logically. Because whatever happens to us, we know we are God's children. That stays with us no matter how bad anything gets, that we know God loves us. We know that we are forgiven. We know that we are saved. We know that we have eternal life. So in our knower, we can know that we have joy. In ourselves, we can have joy through the power of the Holy Spirit growing his fruit in us. We have joy. Be joyful always. And pray. Pray without ceasing. Be joyful always. Pray without ceasing. Now, Paul's not thinking that we're all going to try repeating the Lord's Prayer from this point until the day we die. He's not thinking that we're going to keep our mouths moving, getting prayers out. He's saying, let the spirit of prayer permeate your lives. get deep into every part of your lives. So there is no place that is unacceptable for prayer. That you can take prayer, that you can take God with you into every part of your life. So that you are praying about everything in your life. So you are not hiding things from Him. So He is in everything. Pray without ceasing. And give thanks in all circumstances. Give thanks in every circumstance. So we know Paul's had some rough times and he's still giving thanks. We see that he's calling us, no matter what's happening, to give thanks, because we can give thanks that we have a loving Heavenly Father. We can give thanks that we are saved. We can give thanks for the eternal life we are given. We have to be grateful in all circumstances, no matter how bad things can get. This one came to me very personally when my mum died. So my mum died 12 years ago on Thursday this week. She would be 71 today. And when she died, I tried to pray. It was like the moment after. We were in the hospice. It was the morning. And I went out to the outside with some trees and some fresh air. And I was trying to pray. And I was started with that kind of, why? Do you know, I tried to say to God, why have you done that? Do you know, why is that allowed? Why should that happen? And I couldn't get that out. It wasn't verbal, but it wasn't a prayer I could say. I felt like God stopping me say that. And so then I remember trying to look after my mum, bless my mum. And that one wouldn't come out. Do you know, it was a prayer I felt I shouldn't say. And the only prayer that would come, and I felt God was telling me to pray it, was, thank you for her life. And that came out completely. Thank you, God, for my mum. And I'm not saying that because it was super holy, because it wasn't me. Do you know, I wasn't doing, look at me in this circumstance. I was just there, and I realized it was the only prayer I could give then. And it just applies to this verse I believe God gave me. Give thanks even in that circumstance. Give thanks in all circumstances. And do not quench the Spirit. Do not despise prophecies, but test everything. Hold fast what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. And this was the key for me. You can imagine why this was important for me when I was 18 and going through these things, with the experiences I was having, wondering whether this was God or whether we were making it up whether we were being manipulated or whether it was the Holy Spirit moving in us. And this verse just struck me entirely. Do not quench the Spirit, but test everything. And the first thing that struck me was, it's possible to do that. Do you know, you might think, well, you can't quench the Spirit. That's from God. God will do it, come what may. But Paul's saying, well, there's ways that we can quench the Spirit. That the Holy Spirit moving among us, we can have a negative effect on that with our cynicism, with our criticism, with our doubt. But he also says it's all right to test everything. That we are supposed to use the gifts that God's given us, the resources he's given us, his word, the minds he's given us, the fellowship he's given us, the leadership he's given us, to test everything. So we're not supposed to simply blindly swallow everything that somebody says the Holy Spirit's done. We're not just supposed to go, oh yes, I have to believe, otherwise I'm not a good Christian. We are allowed, we are supposed to test everything. But it's like an equation with two sides. We can also test everything to the point where we quench the Spirit. We're not to quench the Spirit, but we are to test everything. This was deep for me because I took that straight into my Christian life and applied it in these situations where people were being healed miraculously. It was wonderful. And you can test that and say, wonderful, I celebrate this miraculous healing. In these other situations where people were saying, oh, I feel so excited because of this and that. And you can say, well, I'm testing that and I'm saying, it's great, God invented excitement, but it's probably more likely to be adrenaline in that circumstance. Do you know? You test everything, but do not quench the Spirit. And hold all of this. in this situation of holding to what is good and abstaining from evil. Hold to what is good, abstain from evil, be open to the Spirit, do not quench the Spirit, test everything, do not despise prophecies. And the beautiful thing about this sentence is it's good for everybody. Because there's probably a whole range of opinions in this church about how the Holy Spirit works, about how miracles happen, about how God is going to work in the world. We probably have the whole gamut here. But all of us, as followers of Christ, should be able to agree on this. That if we are followers of Christ, we do not want to quench the Spirit and despise prophecies. If we are one of those kind of full-on crazy charismatics, we are open to testing everything as we're called to. But we should not quench the Spirit. And then we get Paul's beautiful blessing. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He will surely do it. And then he asks them to do something for him. Brothers, pray for us. Greet all the brothers with a holy kiss. I put you under oath before the Lord to have this letter read to all the brothers. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. This is the kind of church I want us to be. This is the perfect church, to my mind. A church which is full of joy, where we know the joy of knowing Jesus. We know the joy of the love of God. We know the joy of being forgiven, the joy of being saved, and we want to share that joy. We are joyful in all circumstances, where we pray without ceasing. I want us to be a church of prayer, where we are just always linked with God through prayer, hearing from God, listening to God, wanting to speak with our Maker, our Father, where we are grateful, where we give thanks no matter what, where we give thanks to God for all that he has done for us. A church which is full of the Spirit, open to the movement of the Holy Spirit, and a church which is delighted in good and abhors all evil, where we encourage and help each other with patience. Let's pray together. Father God, would you move like this among us? Send your Holy Spirit to inspire us, Lord. May the God of peace sanctify this church. Sanctify these people completely. May the God of peace make your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless until the coming of our Lord. Lord God, would you make us the church you want us to be? Would you lead us to encourage and help each other? Would you teach us to be prayerful, to be thankful, to have joy in all you've done? In Jesus' name, amen.